On this channel, I've covered the family trees of famous dynasties from all over the world and from all periods of history, from the pharaohs of ancient Egypt to the medieval Tang dynasty of China to the current line of succession to the British throne. But there's one family that I've not yet talked about, my own. So that's what I'm going to do in this video. Now, you might be thinking, you're no one special. Why would I want to learn about your family? Well, the great thing about genealogy is that you can use anyone's family tree to teach a bit of history, whether that person is a monarch of a major country, or whether that person is just some guy from Canada with a YouTube channel. This video is actually part of a large collaboration between a bunch of different genealogy YouTubers, and the focus of the collaboration is on the topic of migration. So in this video, I'll be focusing on three different migration stories from my own family tree and showing you how they fit into the bigger story of world history in general. To find the full playlist for the Project Genealogy collaboration, check out the link in the description. At the bottom of the chart, I've made a fairly typical family tree diagram. I have myself at the bottom, and then I have my parents and grandparents. For the sake of privacy, I've left off the names and dates for these two generations. However, these four photos are in fact photos of my four grandparents, none of whom are still living, but all of whom I had the opportunity to know when I was younger. The people on this next line are my great-grandparents, and like everyone else, I have eight of them. And fortunately, I'm privileged enough to have information about all eight individuals. I know their names, their dates, and I have photos for all but one of them. In fact, two of them I was able to meet as a child. Now, I could go into detail about the lineage of each one of these individuals, but instead I'm going to focus on only three. And that's because many of my ancestors share a fairly similar story. These five all share this basic story. These two share this basic story. And there's only one that stands out with a story that's somewhat unique. And I'm actually going to start with that one, since it's the oldest of the three stories. My paternal grandmother's mother had the last name Levy, a name that can also be spelled L-E-V-I and pronounced Levi. Most people will recognize this as being a Jewish surname. This name kind of stands out on my family tree because my ancestors were generally all Christians, not Jews. So early on in my genealogical research, I figured that there might be some sort of interesting story in this line. And indeed there was. My great-grandmother was a direct descendant of an individual named Moses Levy, who happened to be one of the earliest Jewish settlers to the United States. He was born extremely rich, and that's why a painting of him exists to this day. He was born in Germany, but in the late 1600s, he immigrated to New York City. Just a few decades before this, New York was actually a Dutch colony and was known as New Amsterdam. But in 1664, it was taken over by the British and therefore started to become populated by individuals loyal to Great Britain. Nowadays, New York is known for having a large Jewish population. But keep in mind that most of the Jews living in New York today trace their roots to immigrants who arrived via Ellis Island just over 100 years ago. So my ancestor is not part of their story. Most of the Jews who arrived in Ellis Island were quite poor and were escaping persecution in Eastern Europe. Moses Levy, on the other hand, was a wealthy trader who owned lots of ships, and that's why he was able to settle in America much earlier. Because he was a prominent person, there's lots of information available about him. For example, there's a record of him donating money for the construction of the first Anglican church in New York City. We also know that at one point he served as the president of the first Jewish congregation in the United States. There's also a newspaper article about the first Jewish cemetery in Philadelphia, which was built by his son, but was vandalized by anti-Semites. Anyway, in 1720, a person was born whose name was either Nathan, Nathaniel, or Jonathan. The records that I have are conflicting on that. And there are also conflicting reports about who his father was. He was either a son of Moses himself or the son of one of Moses's two eldest sons. Based on the dates, I get the feeling that he was perhaps a grandson born when his parents were still teenagers, and that's why he sometimes gets listed as the son of his grandfather instead. But what I do know for sure is that he ended up in Nova Scotia, north of New York, and that later in life he married a Christian and converted to Anglicanism. His descendants ended up living on Tangook Island, which is where most of my other ancestors lived. I'll tell you a little more about Tangook in a moment. If you're interested in learning more about Jewish genealogy, you'll want to check out the video in this collaboration by the Genie Vlogger, which I've linked to in the description. Okay, so now let's go to the second migration story. And this is the main one for my family because most of my ancestors can trace their lines to this particular event in history. It's called the Foreign Protestant Migration, and to explain it, let me tell you a bit of Canadian history. For thousands of years, the area now called Nova Scotia was home to a First Nations people called the Mi'kmaq. Then, in the 1600s, the French built some colonies there and named it Acadia. But eventually, in the 1700s, the British defeated the French and took over the colony. Their colony, however, still mostly consisted of French Catholics. So they did two things. First, they approached their Protestant allies on the European continent and said, hey, if anyone wants to come over to our new colony, we'll give you free land, free tools, and some animals to start a farm. So a bunch of Germans, as well as a few French Protestants, including many of my ancestors, said, sure, sounds like a good deal. That's why they were called foreign Protestants. Foreign because they weren't actually British, although they were expected to be loyal to the British crown, and Protestant because the whole goal was to shift the balance away from the French Catholics. The second thing the British did was really quite nasty. They kicked out many of the French Acadians who had been living in Nova Scotia for a long time. Many of these people ended up way down in Louisiana and became known as Cajuns. Acadian. Cajun. Get it? Anyway, one of the German settlers who came over to replace the Acadians was a man named Johann Becker. Now, today my surname is Baker, but originally it was Becker, just like the famous German tennis player Boris Becker. But like many people who migrated to North America in those days, the family eventually changed their name to something more English-sounding, so Becker became Baker. Most of the foreign Protestants who settled in Nova Scotia in the 1750s settled in an area known as Lunenburg, named after the House of Brunswick Lunenburg, which the British kings belonged to. Near Lunenburg are two islands known as Big Tangook and Little Tangook. They are also close to Peggy's Cove, a popular tourist destination for those visiting Nova Scotia. My paternal line ancestor, Johann Becker, bought most of Big Tangook and divided the land amongst his children. My great-great-grandfather, Andrew Baker, was one of the first people to live on the island. Over the next few generations, several other families, such as the Crosses, the Langells, the Levies, the Hutts, and the Stevens, came to live there too. In fact, five generations of Bakers lived on that island, all the way down to my own father, who finally moved off the island with his parents when he was 10. He then met my mother, whose father's ancestors had also come from Tangook, but whose mother's ancestors had a different story. And this brings us to my third and final migration story. But before that, I should point out that if you're interested in learning more about German migration to North America, you'll want to check out the video in this collaboration by the channel Auntie Jen's Family Trees, which I've linked to in the description. Okay, so story number three. My maternal grandmother was Catholic, unlike my other three grandparents who were all Protestant. Her ancestors were Irish immigrants who, like many Irish immigrants to the United States, came to North America around 1850, following the Great Potato Famine in Ireland. It's a pretty simple story. There was a really bad blight on potato crops in Ireland around that time, made worse by some bad government policies. So lots of Irish people ended up migrating overseas to escape the famine and to start new lives in North America. This branch of my family was among them. If you're interested in learning more about Irish migration, you'll want to check out the video in this collaboration by Terry O'Connell, which I've linked to in the description. Before I go, I want to mention that one of my most interesting ancestors comes from the Irish branch of my family. Edward Condon was a second-generation Irish immigrant living in Halifax, which is the capital city of the province of Nova Scotia. By the time World War I occurred, he had become the top fire chief in the city, and unfortunately ended up dying in the line of duty during one of Canada's worst wartime tragedies. Halifax is a port city, and during World War I, there was all kinds of boats coming and going, carrying ammunition and supplies for the war. In December of 1917, two ships collided in Halifax Harbor, starting a fire. One of the ships was full of ammunition, and you can probably guess what happened next. There was a huge explosion, and several blocks of the city were completely leveled, killing about 2,000 people and injuring 9,000. At the time, it was actually the largest man-made explosion in human history, only to be surpassed by the nuclear explosions during the next World War. To give you an idea of how large the blast was, the bomb dropped on Hiroshima was the equivalent of 15 kilotons of TNT. The Halifax explosion was the equivalent of 3. So not nuclear size, but still pretty big. Just before the explosion, my great-great-grandfather was on his way to the harbor to put out the fire. When the blast occurred, he died alongside 8 other firefighters from his firehouse. 2 generations later, my maternal grandmother married my maternal grandfather, who had signed up in 1939 at age 19 to fight in the Second World War. He lived through that war and had my mother, who of course went on to have me. So colonial wars, the world wars, and people moving around the globe simply because they want a safe place to grow food and have a family. Anybody's family tree, whether you're famous or not, is going to be impacted by similar events in world history, and therefore the more you learn about your own genealogy or the genealogy of others, the more you're going to learn about history. If you find history, genealogy, and monarchies interesting, be sure to subscribe to the channel. If you check the playlists, you'll find that I have videos covering the family trees of famous dynasties from all over the world. And to see what else I'm up to, follow me on Twitter or Instagram. Thanks for watching.